Right. Massive inside. Toronto inside. Oh, yeah, we're broken wild.
Welcome to the evolution of drum and bass in Toronto. I'm Chris McKee. Drum and bass has its beginnings in Toronto in 1992, and it's important to understand what was happening in the city that helped nurture this music and understand what events helped make it what it is today. In 92, the city of Toronto was just beginning to find its own identity and was becoming a world-class city in both sports and in music. The downtown core of Toronto, although a burgeoning city, still had many vacant warehouses, which have since been turned into high-priced condos and office space. But back in 92, well before Drake owned this city, some other young DJs and producers in Toronto started to make use of those warehouses in the downtown core.
Beginnings, the first time Toronto caught any rumblings of jungle or drum and bass, at the time so-called jungle techno or hardcore, from my understanding, was Malik X's show Radio London. He was touching on a lot of stuff that was happening in London at the time, and then of course as hardcore and jungle started becoming huge in London, he started playing it on his radio show here. That was the first time I think a lot of, I'm assuming North Americans, heard drum and bass or jungle or hardcore, whatever you want to call it at that time, right? I would say if somebody is going to take the credit for launching jungle in North America, it's gonna have to be Malik and Neo, Dr. No and Malik X for sure.
Okay, for me, the way I connect with drum and bass in Toronto and the first time I really heard it was actually a DJ named Dr. No, and it was at a delirium party, actually Psychosis. And I heard this music, which kind of, because I'm a huge hip hop and house head and techno head, like Detroit techno, I heard this like music with like a frenetic pace that just had an element of soul, it had an element of house, it had an element of electro, it had an element of 303s, like acid house, with like hip hop loops, the break beats, the Amen drum. And it just hypnotized me because it wasn't like anything else I've heard. And I heard Dr. No playing like Production House, Ibiza Recordings, I believe was another label that was really good, Sub Bass. And I would hear him playing these records, and then I would hear guys like Roughneck, Mark Oliver even, Marcus, the Delirium Parties, Alex of London. Those are my early experiences with breakbeat hardcore slash drum and bass.
Again, Malik, Mark Oliver, Dr. No, and Sean L, the Booming System Collective. So those four really pushed that sound. Roughneck came in shortly after as well. Steve Roughneck, he was playing a lot of, he was the guy that was like, you expect just jungle from him and nothing else. Those are the beginnings. I remember chemistry raves would have some jungle in there as well, but the guys that really said 100% jungle from beginning to end, if my memory doesn't fail me, Psychosis and Delirium.
23 Hop. Dr. No, Mark Oliver. Back then, Mark Oliver was even playing, you know what I mean? Mark Oliver was playing all the hardcore breakbeat kind of stuff. And yeah, I just remember it was like 318 Richmond, 23 Hop, completely black room. All I had was a smoke machine, a green laser. And it was the coolest thing I had ever seen.
Cyrus laid the groundwork for what a drum and bass rave in Toronto should be like. But in the late 90s, other companies in Toronto started producing world-class drum and bass events, and crowds began to flock by the thousands.
The first time I really got sparked on drum and bass I got handed a flyer, and the flyer had just the head of the Terminator 2 robot. And it was a party called Judgment Day by a newer company called Cyrus. I think it was their second event. And they were showcasing hardcore, but calling it jungle. And there was a DJ on there named Kenny Ken from the UK, who was pretty much the godfather, who helped bring this music over here and expose it.
Cyrus was the epitome of quality. It was the epitome of unique. They had incredible venues all the time, different venues usually, monstrous sound system and production. I think that was extremely important. Cyrus deserves the accolades, in my opinion, that they've gotten, because they really pushed the boundaries, man. They set the standards.
Chris Smart was doing it. I think he did the first party kind of on his own, or he had somebody else involved, and then Robbie and Vito got involved on the second Cyrus show, which was turned out to be Judgment Day. Kenny Ken, you know, that was the landmark drum and bass show.
Cyrus, when they first brought Kenny Ken, the flyer had a Terminator on it.
The Cyrus Judgment Day rave, which was the first time that Kenny Ken came to town. And that was the night that most guys in Toronto will assert that was the night that the music kind of changed. Before that night, guys were still kind of playing jungle techno. They were still playing sped up four to the floor stuff that had kind of a little break in it. After Kenny showed up that night and he played original Nutta, he played a lot of the older stuff on sub bass this is jungle now. This is a different genre of music. So honorable mention to Judgment Day, Cyrus Judgment Day. That was a big, big turning point in Toronto jungle raving as well.
To be completely honest with you, the first mega rave was AWOL to me. Delirium was doing really big parties, Pleasure Force, Atlantis, a lot of big companies were doing big shows, but the first show that I actually thought was considered to be a massive show was AWOL. It was AWOL. It was multi-headliners, and before then it was like one, maybe two headliners, which at that point was sufficient. The music was so new, local DJs were treated with the same respect as international DJs, and you can get away with it. But, you know, when you started bringing multiple headliners in, it just changed the landscape completely. And we've just gone up and up and up from there to the point where it is now, where, I don't know, it seems like it's very difficult to go backwards from.
The scene was growing exponentially through a few outlets that were doing incredible events, like really introducing new elements to the city, you know, parties at the docks for 3,000 people were the norm, you know. There was a company called AWOL that came over here, a group from guys from Toronto came over, and they brought an element from England over here that was more than just talent, you know. It was an actual company that had built, was a main player in development of drum and bass, and, you know, brought the whole experience here. You know, we were going to events where Cyrus was putting on, 20,000 people Halloween events with 10 headliners, you know, and these numbers were at the time when they were coming out, were coming by fluke, right? Because nobody really knew where this was gonna stop. Like, people just kept coming.
I think, you know, there was a period where UK was the strongest scene, obviously.
Yeah.
And then it was either Toronto or New Zealand. They were the three guaranteed great gigs. And that's what, that's probably going back up until about 2004, 2005. They were the gigs you looked forward to. You knew you were going to a good gig. You'd get on a plane, you were going to a good gig. Like, New Zealand and Toronto were always like the second home for the music, almost, or the first home outside of the UK, almost.
Yeah.
You know, that really got it, that understood it.
We didn't really get rolling until we did One Sound. And that was our first all drum and bass main stage, showcased the local drum and bass talent. And that was at the warehouse, or sorry, at the Opera House in 1999. And it was the first time that Toronto had gotten over 1,000 people for an all local drum and bass event. At the time, everybody, all the main promoters were bringing in, you know, big headline talent, multiple DJs, multiple MCs from England. And it was what was selling the events to the masses. It was what was growing the industry and growing the scene, which is great.
The publicity, you know what I mean? When they started getting that big, publicity. So then people started taking notice, cops, the city, stuff like that, you know.
The cops were all on our side really at the beginning.
Well, as long as you were paying them, they were cool, you know? Like,
it wasn't until Mel Lastman kind of came in.
Yeah. You know, the logistics changed after that. You couldn't just find a warehouse, put some sound in it, and be done with it. You know, you had to start getting fire marshals involved, hiring pay duty cops.
The amount of people that started coming, you couldn't do it without getting shut down, without having the pay duties. Really,
you know, you had the pay duties. You know, you had them on the payroll. Your venue was good.
Yeah.
Well, it got so big so fast that people didn't know how to handle it. You know.
The S, the N, the I, the B, E, R, the sniper.
With the mega raves in full swing throughout Toronto around the turn of the millennium, the scene was also blossoming into nightclubs in the downtown core. It was around that same time that many of Toronto's DJs began hitting the studio and producing homegrown drum and bass of their own. Vinyl Syndicate was the first label to break ground. Soon to follow were labels like Jedi Records, Placebo, and Furious. Toronto finally had a soundtrack of their own.
The energy, energy, it's the energy builder.
Dubplate Pressure was like a 2-year journey that started.
Yeah, like I don't.
It started with a guy named Chameleon.
Chameleon, Aaron
the Chameleon.
Yeah, Aaron
played
Pleasure Force Party.
He was a Pleasure Force.
The first Dubplate Pressure was made with him.
Yeah.
You know, we made it with him on a Kurzweil keyboard.
Yeah.
Like it was all done on a keyboard, and like the original Dubplate that I first started playing out was made with Chameleon.
And then
we met Slip.
Yeah, and Slip was like begging us to come over to his studio.
Slip was just this little raver kid and begged us and begged us and begged us to go in. Like, he had a studio and he's making tunes, and he bugged us forever, and we were just like, finally, you know, we didn't know him, whatever, he's just some little raver kid. So finally we were like, okay, you know, let's do it. And we went in with Dubplate Pressure. We never, you know what I mean, we never really finished it the way we wanted it. So we went back in the studio with Slip and came out with a monster.
Now listen.
The tune was originally made to be on the Cyrus info line, and then I think that people started leaving messages like, what is this, what is this? And then they eventually put it out. But the first time I heard Pat playing it, it was the Cyrus VIP still, right? So it was Cyrus, massive, mystical influence, all the time stretching and everything. And then he's got the GQ sample and the Fearless sample in there.
The funniest thing is that the tune was never made to be a tune to play out. The whole idea behind it was Robbie wanted something for the info line.
Yeah.
He wanted a tune to play on the info line, so we were making just a background tune for the Cyrus info lines. Like, remember, you used to call the info lines and it would play a tune for a minute and then they'd tell you the details.
That was it.
That's what Dubplate Pressure was for. And it got such a good response that like people wanted to hear it at the party. So I think the first time I played it, it was like 6 rewinds, people went fucking mad.
Let Me Know, Slip and Slide, and then right there, that was a huge tune. That, I mean, you go on eBay right now, I'm sure it's like going for like 200, 300 bucks now to grab that piece of vinyl because it's so rare. And it's an amazing tune that you play now. It's just timeless. It works. I mean, if you're in Toronto, you know that tune. It's just synonymous, drum and bass in Toronto.
Like, that record was an absolute anthem in Toronto. You couldn't go anywhere without it. And people felt a real close connection with that record as well, you know, and the same that they did with Dubplate Pressure. So I think, to me, that, you know, Let Me Know probably number two.
It's pretty strange, really. I mean, it's completely different now, where drum and bass is world, it's from the music from the world. But if you go back in time, it was all from the UK, and I guess myself included, we all felt really proud of that, and it was a hard sell for people who made music outside of the UK to be accepted in the UK. And I guess some of the Toronto artists were some of the first artists to really break through, you know what I mean?
Every style of music has songs that define a certain era. There is one producer who single-handedly was responsible for creating a soundtrack for a generation of ravers in Toronto, and that was DJ Slip.
The guys who really put Toronto, you know, who really ran the Toronto flag when it comes to production, I mean, Slip has to be the guy that's up there, right? When Superman Tune dropped and Mickey picked it up and took it over, man, like, that was, Toronto was flying high. Vinyl Syndicate was flying high, right?
Like, Slip was the studio genius.
Yeah.
You know, we learned over time with him, but, like, you know, we just had ideas. Slip was instrumental. Like, if it wasn't for Slip, we would have never got any of those tunes made. We had ideas that we needed to translate, and Slip was the guy that could work the buttons and make it happen.
Yeah.
But like, even Superman, Slip begged us for 2 years to make a tune with that Superman theme, and I thought, like, oh, that's fucking stupid, we're not gonna do that, it's ridiculous.
He had the whole tune laid out, we went to listen to
so
it.
So finally, we went to the studio to work on other stuff,
yeah.
And Slip was like,
played it.
And
Slip went out, we went outside, I think I went out for a smoke, and Slip had this kind of stupid bass line in it, and he was fucking around with the wheel on the...
You were out having a smoke,
yeah.
Slip went to the washroom, and I'm just sitting there in front of the computer waiting for him to come back, and the tune was looped and the bass line was just like
this. With a wheel, and
I started,
like,
yeah.
Don't just keep doing what you're doing, I'm gonna record it. And so he recorded it live. And that's how we came up with it.
But it was, yeah, like, we never, you know what I mean, we didn't, yeah. Like I said, we had no idea that any of those tunes were ever gonna be what they were.
DJ Slip laid the groundwork, but Toronto now features a whole slew of young producers releasing music on the biggest drum and bass labels all over the world.
There's a new guy out of Toronto, and his name's Bensley, and he's got a track called Tiptoe. It's coming out on Ram Records, and it's to me, it's something that's gonna be something played for years to come. There's such an abundance of music that's coming out on that level. It's a question I can't really answer. I can't pick five tunes. I play so much of Canadian content, whether it's at live sets or on Prophecy Radio. There's just no stopping. I mean, play a couple tunes, just more coming out. It's so lush and vibrant right now.
Max Mash, Schematic, Hungry Tea, Artifice, the stuff that Marcus and Brad are putting out on Inner City Dance, I mean, there's so much, RMS, I already said Artifice, what's the other kid's name, Decision. These kids are making amazing music, man, like, top shelf, good quality music. For a long time, music is being produced in Toronto. It was like, I mean, it's there, I get the idea, maybe it's not mastered as well, maybe we didn't have the ability to mix these records so that they're as powerful and as impactful as the Ram Records of England, you know what I mean? But now, I think Canada, I think Toronto, the guys from Toronto, man, we're up to par. I think that drum and bass is at its best right now. Having seen it evolve from essentially its birth to now, I know a lot of people will probably disagree with me on this, but I think drum and bass is the best it's ever been right now in terms of the music that's being produced out of Toronto, in terms of the events that are happening in Toronto. We have the most diverse events that we've ever had in the history of this city. For a very long time, Toronto was either stuck on just jump up-y kind of stuff or more cheesy, poppy kind of drum and bass. And now we're seeing across the spectrum, we're seeing guys who, you know, are smaller, you know, smaller artists on smaller labels come in and do 500-700 people, you know, and then we're still seeing the Andy C's, we're still seeing the Nets guys, we're still seeing these big marquee drum and bass shows being heavily supported, but we also have the opportunity to see Caliber come and play a set, or Marcus Intalex, or Ivy Lab, or any of these new guys that are really making drum and bass exciting. So I don't think drum and bass has ever been as good as it is.
I felt it important to celebrate the history of this music in Toronto, but I also can't wait to see what the future holds.
But if you listen to mainstream music, you've got people singing about something, and you're hearing their story about whatever that song happens to be about. You're sharing that memory of that person. You play a drum and bass track, 10 different people. 10 different people are going to have 10 different feelings about that one track, and that's what's so amazing about it. It's so abstract, it's so broad, and that music definitely appeals to me. I come from a background where I listen to a lot of house, disco, ska, punk, reggae, you name it. I've listened to everything over the span of my life, and drum and bass just has something that applies to anyone. You want liquid? There you go. If you like R&B, we've got liquid. You like heavy stuff? We've got that. Whatever you need. Like, you like reggae? We got that too. Drum and bass covers it all. And it is by far the best music ever. And there's never going to be an end to it because it's so multifaceted. It can do anything you want it to do.
It's no wonder that people that went raving around that time still to this day speak of it like it was a religious experience. It's all the pieces of the puzzle were there. The recipe was perfect for this thing to be impactful and to really immerse itself in these kids' lives, man. That's the reason why this music has been able to flourish so much of us on this side of the pond, you know, is those amazing experiences.